But I need to talk to you today, not just about Lazarus. As we look at the story, we see some people in the story. We see Lazarus. We see his family. And we see all the other people. Some of them are defined as disciples. Now, as we look at this story, I just want to preach for just a few minutes, just share with you, if I will, from the subject, No More Stones. Look at somebody around you and say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
No more stones. As I look, First Lady, and thank God for our First Lady and our Bishop today, we honor them. All the ministers, every one of your respective places. So look at the text today, ladies and gentlemen. I'll just give you a quick synopsis of the text. I'm not going to make the assumption that everybody knows the text. But Lazarus was a man, John chapter 11, Lazarus was, it's the story of Lazarus, and the Bible said that he was sick. He was sick, and so his sisters sent to Jesus and said, the one who you love is sick. And Jesus was in a whole nother city at the time, and the Bible declares that when they told him that he was sick, Jesus did not go at the time. Matter of fact, he told his disciples that this sickness was not unto death. But he went on to say that the Son of God might be glorified through this. Bishop said something earlier that I think bears repeating right here, because he said he asked every one of us that wanted to, who had another yes down in your spirit. And I heard he even asked the question, how many volunteers do we have in the sanctuary for another yes? Well, I come to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, that you got to be careful when you say yes to God. Can I preach like I feel like preaching today? You got to be careful when you say yes to God, Granny, because yes to God does not always mean that everything is going to be comfortable, Minister Sandra, the way you want it to be. Sometimes God may allow you to get put in some uncomfortable positions, some things that are not good, some things that don't feel good, all so that he can get some glory. Lazarus had fallen sick in his body, and Jesus makes a statement. He says, this sickness is not unto death, but that the Son of Man or the Son of God might be glorified. My question to you today is, if you got to go through whatever you got to go through, are you willing to go through it so the Son of God can get some glory?
Yes, yes, yes.
Who's going to help me preach in here today? I thought I was in Kingdom Life. I said, now, it's not always going to be comfortable. It's not going to always be easy. Sometimes, watch this. Sometimes you're going to deal with some stuff that doesn't feel good. Here's Lazarus, the Bible says, laying in the bed, sick. Now, that's the implication, because watch this. He had to be at least somewhat bedridden or paralyzed, because notice something. Most people don't pay attention to this in the text. It was not Lazarus that sent for Jesus. Y'all not talking. It was not Lazarus that sent for Jesus in the text. It was his sisters that sent for Jesus in the text. That's because sometimes you will have some stuff in your life that we call paralyzed places. We don't necessarily have a definition of what his paralyzed place was. It might not have been something that was in his legs, but just the fact that something in his body had afflicted him so much that he was not able to make the move to even ask Jesus to come and see about him proves to me that there were some paralyzed places. I told you there's three categories of people in here. One of you is the Lazarus folk, that you're dealing with some paralyzed
eyes. And am I talking to anybody up in here? If you look at your life, that for one reason or another, there is some paralyzed places. As much, Rolando, as they may want to move, when you've got paralyzed places, your mind may say move, but your body can't make a... Any of y'all ever been sick or ever been dealing with something and you really wanted to move, but you could not move because you had some paralyzed places? There's some people in here right now. You want to move from one place to another in your spirit, in your walk with God, in your heart, in your mind. You want to move, but you're dealing with some paralyzed places.
So what happens is when you have paralyzed places, it affects your productivity.
Yeah.
Oh God.
Yes, it does.
It affects your ability to be productive.
Yes.
That's a struggle in your life when you're trying to be. Now let me work right here for just a minute, because it's frustrating, Mr. Sandra. It's real frustrating when you really want to be productive. You really want to do good things. You really want to do what's right. And in the middle of all of that, you got your paralyzed places that are preventing you from being productive. Somebody ought to help me up in here. That stuff that keeps preventing you from being productive, Kiesha. You can't do what you want to do. Can't move forward in your life. Yeah. Preventing you from being... Wait a minute, can I work a little deeper?
Yeah,
okay. It not only affects you in your physical body, but it also affects your psyche.
Yeah.
When you want to do something, when you want to make progress in your life, move, and you can't make progress in your life, you're trying to move forward, it can get frustrating.
Yes.
Am I talking right? Wait, and Paul said it like this: every time I try to do what's good, evil is always present. I got something that keeps trying to press me. I'm trying to break free, and even though I'm trying to move forward, because of my paralyzed places, I'm frustrated because I can't move like I want to move.
Still see what happened in the past. I said, well, daughter, all you got to do is learn how to
get past your past? Well, how do I get past the past? Start living in today. And the Holy Ghost began to tell me when she comes, and she comes, she's going to deal with some stuff, and she's not going to always act right, because again, she's got some paralyzed, y'all not talking. She's got some paralyzed places. But God told me, just because she's got paralyzed places doesn't mean you drop her. He said you love her through her paralyzed places. Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. How do you love paralyzed places?
Yes.
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 Well, told you three categories of folk in the story.
Yes.
One was Lazarus, the man who was sick, and ultimately he ended up dying.
Uh-huh.
We'll come back to that in a minute. But you have Lazarus, and then, ladies and gentlemen, you have his family. The people who had to deal with his paralyzed places. Y'all not talking. It's hard sometimes to be the caretaker of a son that's in a paralyzed place. Can I preach like I feel it in here? It's hard to be in a place where you're dealing with the caretaker of a husband who's in a paralyzed place. It's hard to be in a caretaker of a child who's in a paralyzed place. But God have mercy. There is a grace available when you're dealing with somebody in a paralyzed place. How do you find the grace to deal with somebody in a paralyzed place? You go back and look at yourself and remember when you were in a paralyzed place.
Yes,
yes,
sir.
Yes,
yes,
sir.
Yes, sir.
And I'm paralyzed. Don't sit down. You're making me nervous. Now, as I thought about this, it got real interesting real fast. Because the family called Jesus, asked him to come. They knew that he loved them. Anybody in here know he loves you? But what do you do when his behavior, his response, oh God, when his response to your request doesn't look like he loves you the way he says he does? None of y'all in here have ever been there. When his response to your request doesn't look like he said he loves you like he said he does. Here you are praying, you're fasting, you're trying to get your life together, you're walking with him the best way you know how, and lo and behold, you ask a request and it seems like it's getting worse before it gets better. Am I talking to anybody in here?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes.
Well, like it's getting worse before it gets better. The family was in a position, and I know there's about five of y'all in here that will holler back at me on this. They were waiting on a miracle. Yes, we are. Oh, God, yes, we are. Yes, we are. Waiting on. Waiting. Not even, okay, moving on. Yeah. Waiting on. Can I get about three screamers in here that will say, I'm waiting on my miracle. Waiting. Wait, do I have about five folk in here that say, I'm waiting. And the thing is, they were believing while they were waiting. Got somebody around and say, if you're going to wait, you better believe while you're waiting. If you're going to wait, you better believe while you're waiting. If you're going to wait, you better start shouting. Oh, Lord, I need a church right here. If you're going to wait, you better start shouting while you're waiting. If you're going to wait, you ought to start praising while you're waiting. Now, I looked around the room. Oh, God, have mercy. I looked around the room this morning, and some folk looked like they were a coward at Newgate. Didn't understand what was going on when praise and worship was happening. to prod you. Nobody should have to pull you to make you praise him. If you're waiting, you ought to be believing. If you're believing, then you ought to be praising. My praise is a response to what I believe, even when I don't see it. I tell you what, I'm going to give y'all about 30 seconds to practice what you're going to do while you're waiting. Take 30 seconds right here and do what you're going to do while you're waiting. Some of what y'all need around here, you don't need to be giving them a cute praise. You need to give them a radical praise. Tell them how much you expect. Tell them how much you believe. Oh, I need my children to help me praise them. Hey! That's it. I hear you. I hear you. I hear you. Somebody ought to open your mouth and tell them that you believe. Tell them I receive. Tell them I praise you in advance. Tell them I rejoice right now. Everything I'm believing for, one way or another. God, I thank you. I dare you. I'm gonna give you 5 more seconds to go ahead and do what you're gonna do. I'm gonna give you 5 more. 5. Come on, you better get it. 5. 4, 3, 2. Watch this.
Yes, Lord.
Your maturity in God is revealed by how you handle delay. Let me say that again. I said your maturity in God is revealed by how you handle delay. You need your finances turned around, and now you're getting all worried and all messed up because your finances don't look like they're turning as fast as you think they ought to be turning.
Yes, sir.
Your maturity in God is revealed by how you handle delay. Y'all ever notice? Y'all ever notice how we'll shout when he comes through early? But we struggle when he seems to come through late? Y'all not talking to me up in here. I said, have you ever noticed that we will shout when God seems to come through early, but then we'll struggle when he seems to be coming through later than we expected? Oh yeah, that's what we do in church. We'll shout, we'll rejoice, we'll holler, we'll scream when the check comes in the mail.
That's right.
But what happens when you've been waiting on things and they have not happened? What happens when they are delayed? Can I work right here for a moment? Jesus said to the crowd right after he did the miracle to the fish and the loaves, first lady, the Bible said that he left that side of the water and went over to the other side. And the Bible said that they went looking for him on that first side and they could not find him. So they found boats. They found something to get into to go to the other side. And they found him over there. And Jesus said to them, you didn't come over here looking for me. You came because I did the fishes and the loaves. My question is, are you serving and trusting and walking with him over the stuff that he can give you, over the miracle that he can work, or do you want him whether he does it or not?
Yes.
They didn't holler back that loud on that one, Bishop.
Yes.
They didn't holler loud on that one. The question is, what if his answer is no?
Amen.
I need a church right there. Queen, what if his answer is no? What if you're the Hebrew boy who goes in the fire and this time he doesn't come in the fire?
Yeah.
Y'all not talking? Yeah, he delivered those Hebrew boys, but what if this time it's for the will of God?
Yeah.
I mean, y'all do know John the Baptist died in the prison, right? got his head cut off. If Jesus was going to deliver anybody, he really should have delivered John. That was his cousin. He was close to him. So that, watch this, that proves that no matter how close you are to God, there are some things you will never understand that God may allow you to go through. It will not make sense. Can I add something to this? Can I tell y'all that the only person who's controlled by your deadline is you, not God. The only person who is controlled by your deadline is you, not God. Is there anybody here that's ever given God some deadlines and it seemed like right when you got to the deadline, you look at your watch and God? Okay, God. God? And then we got the nerve. Can I preach like I feel today? Then we got the nerve to turn around, and if God crosses our little deadline, then we say, well, I'll give him a little grace period. Oh, y'all know we do it. We have our period where we think, okay, surely he'll do it by this time. And so we expect it. But then once he crosses that line, then we say, well, maybe after about 3 more months it might happen. Or maybe another month, or maybe another 6 months, maybe another year it might happen by then. Maybe I'll be married by then. Maybe I'll have the house by then. Maybe I'll have a new car by then. Maybe. But when it does, and when it does not happen in the moment when we expect it, even after our grace period, we find ourselves saying, I don't know whether I can. See, we lose a level of our trust in God when he goes past our grace period. Y'all don't want to be honest. And then you're going to be in church and still tell everybody else, I trust him. I need the real folk to holler back at me in here. If you know what I'm talking about, you ought to say, preach, Lord, preach. We say it. I still trust him. You know, that's a religious thing to say. I still trust him, Sister Roslyn. I still trust him. I still trust him, Sister Jamaica. I still trust him. But the truth of the matter is, a level of your faith in God has been dwindled, has been drained because he went past your deadline. I gotta hurry. But I'm reminded of the book of Hebrews, chapter number 11. In the beginning, it talks about the hall of faith. And that's for all these people. And it gives them by name and Abraham and all these folk that got blessed and God showed up for. And they had faith in God. And God gave them a miracle. But watch this. When you get down towards the end of the same chapter, there were some people who were sawed asunder. That means they were cut in half for the cause of God. They were killed by the sword for the cause of God. They were put in lion's dens because of the cause of God. What are you saying, Lord? I'm saying the Bible goes on to say that these all died not having received the promise. Yes. They died. Let me quote it right. It did not say they died not having received. They died in faith. Y'all not hollering back at me. I said they died in they died, Bishop, in faith. Not having received the promise.
Yes, sir.
But they believed that he that gave the promise was still faithful. Yes. Is there anybody in here that still believes that your God, he is faithful?
Yes.
I feel a little holiness in my throat. I better cut back for a minute.
Come on.
So you had the family who was being controlled by their deadlines. How do you know they were controlled by their deadlines? Let me take you further in the story. 2 days later, Jesus decides to show up. And when he decides to show up, he says, he told his disciples before he goes, says, Lazarus is dead now. He said, I'm going to wake him up. I don't know who I'm preaching to today, but God says, I'm coming to wake some stuff up. Oh, did we not just come out of revival? Jesus said, I'm coming in here to wake some stuff. Oh, Lord, have mercy. He said, I'm coming in here to wake some stuff up. Y'all should have shouted right there. I said all it took was one word to wake him up. I come to tell you that all it takes is one word to wake up your situation. One word to wake up your life. One word to wake up your spirit. One word. If you believe it, shout one word.
Was in a condition with their deadline. Yeah. Because when the sister Mary heard that Jesus was coming, the Bible said, Lord have mercy, she went and met him. Uh-huh. Martha went and met him. Uh-huh. Mary sat in the house.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah.
Martha went and met him. Mary sat in the house.
Yeah.
And the first words, Minister Lisa, out of Martha's mouth, if you had
been here.
Deadline.
You have been here.
My deadline.
Yeah.
You didn't meet my deadline. I'm trying to preach to somebody in here today. You didn't, I don't know who I'm talking to, but somebody in here, you recently gave God a deadline. You needed God to give you a miracle and put him on a timeline. God said, just because I don't come when you want me to come, doesn't mean I won't be. Thank y'all for helping me preach. I'm about to close this thing now. I'll give y'all part two next week. But the Bible says she told Jesus, she said, Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. And the Bible said that after she had this conversation, there was a conversation back at the house that said, Mary, Jesus is here. So she got up and she ran out of the house to go see Jesus. And the first word out of Mary's mouth was, if you had been here, then my brother wouldn't have died. But the Bible said that Jesus says, but I am the resurrection. Somebody ought to get happy because he said, I am the resurrection. He said, fear not, I am the resurrection. God told me to, I'm trying not to holler today, mama, but I feel something in my belly. God told me to tell somebody today that he is the resurrection. Y'all gonna help me preach today. I said he is the resurrection. He told me to tell you that I'm gonna do it not the way you expect me to do it, but I'm gonna show up. And the Bible says that Jesus told him, said, don't be afraid. Show me where you're laying. I need to address this thing when Jesus said, don't be afraid. Don't be concerned. Don't be dismayed. I heard my old pastor say, be not dismayed. Lord, I wish I had an old church in here. Whatever be tied. Is there anybody in here that believes that your God will take care of you? And the Bible says that God wanted to deal with their faith. And so listen, can I tell y'all a secret? God told me to tell you anytime I'm getting ready to give you a miracle, I start talking to you about your faith. Anytime I get ready to give you a miracle, I start talking to you about the way you believe. They believe that he can heal Lazarus, but they did not realize that the Jesus they were serving was the same God who can heal the sick. He can raise the dead. Is there anybody that can say today, I'm taking the limits off of my faith, and I'm going to believe him? Is there
everybody in here that God's been talking to you about your level of faith. He's been telling you, take the limits off. He's been telling you, I got plans to bless you. He's been telling you, I got plans to give you a miracle. Is there anybody in here that has heard God deal with you about your faith? If that's you, you ought to praise Him. Why? I feel like preaching. Why am I going to praise Him now? I don't have a miracle yet. Why am I going to praise Him now? Because my brother's still dead. Why am I going to praise Him? I'll tell you why. Look at somebody and say, here's why I'm going to praise Him. The reason why I'm going to praise Him is because if He's dealing with me about my faith and about what I believe, it means I'm on the verge of a miracle. I'm right on the edge of my miracle. Yes, I'm on the edge. Touch somebody and tell them I've been on the edge, but now I'm on the edge of my miracle. Is there anybody that can say I'm on the edge? I'm on the verge of a miracle. You want to holler, that's me, that's me, that's me. That's me, that's me. Granny, that's me. Sister Joyce, that's me. Emmanuel, that's me. I'm on the edge. Yes. 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 And the Bible says, He told him to show me where are you laying? If you're going to get a miracle, you're going to have to show him where the dead thing is in your life. You might mean exposing the stinky stuff. Lord have mercy. But I come to tell you, would you rather? Let me break down right here because I need y'all to hear something. See, when they would bury a body, they didn't have the old embalming, the new embalming techniques we have now. So what they would do, Sister Ethel, is they would put perfumes and oils on the body to cover up the stench. They would do it to honor the dead, but they would do it to cover up the smell. Y'all not gonna help me. I said they would do it to cover up the smell of decay. But one thing about it, when you live in an environment like that, after a while, that's why they bury it within a day or two. Because after a while, whatever you try to cover up, it's still going to stink. I come to tell somebody, you're only going to be able to cover the decaying part only for a little while. We're going to smell it after a while. You can cover it for now, but we're going to smell it after a while. You can cover it for now, but your family's going to smell it after a while. Yes! But if God says, show me where you lay, He's not concerned about the smell. People might be concerned about the decay that's in your life. People might talk about the decay they smell in your life. People may dog you out because of the decay. But I come to tell you, your decay doesn't matter to God. He's coming.
I'm closing on this stone, but I need y'all to hear some more stuff about rolling away the stone. Because I told you there were three categories of people in this text. I've only dealt with two of them. Next week we'll deal with the third one. Ladies and gentlemen, He says, I don't care about the decay. I don't care about what died. Just take me to it.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
parallel for your life.
Yes.
It means you got to be honest with yourself.
Yes.
Most of us are not really honest with ourselves.
Uh-huh. Oh, Lord.
Because we've done so well at making other folks believe we're okay.
Amen.
It's dangerous, Mr. Steve. It's dangerous for an actor to play a part that he never lays down.
Wow.
And that's what we've learned to do in church.
Yeah.
And in my closing today, I'm not saying this to degrade or belittle or to bring harm, but one of our gospel singers, Leandria Johnson, was on social media this week and said some things that were very rough and very heinous. Now, I looked at the church's responses to her outburst. First Lady, much of the church judged her. They basically crucified her. Some of them all in the name of love. But when you have never walked in a position that you're in the limelight or people know you, you don't know the pressures that come with that. And she's fed up. She's broken. She's hurting. And what breaks my heart is that the body of Christ is not loving her back to life. She's wounded. She's even gone as far as to say, I almost walked away from church and everything with it. She did. But can I be honest? She's only voicing what some folks sitting right in this sanctuary have felt and thought, but just weren't bold enough to say.
That's right.
Now, I'm not saying that the forum in which she did it was a good forum to do it. It wasn't healthy. But again, when you're not healthy, you make unhealthy decisions. You don't care where it comes out, how it comes out. It just comes out. When you, excuse me, I don't mean to be too graphic, but y'all just walk with me for a minute. Listen, if you get sick and you got to throw up, you might try to run to the bathroom. But if you're real sick, Brother Robert, it is going to come out wherever it comes out. You just have to clean up whatever you got to clean up. And hopefully there's somebody else who is strong enough around you to help you clean up what you just messed up. Can the prophet come out right now? See, the thing is, some of us were the ones that fed them the stuff that got them sick in the first place. Y'all not talking. Some of the church are the ones who have fed people the stuff that have made them sick. And you sit up and looking at them cross-eyed because they're not in church anymore. It might have been your mean behavior. It might have been your mean behavior that made them walk away from church and walk away from God.
That's right.
I got some help up in here.
You got some help.
It might have been, now you said you were saying to them whatever you were saying in the name of God. But my question is, did God really tell you to say that? What kind of car do you drive?
What?
A Camry.
Okay, so you're a Camry? Now, guess what? My car is a Kia. She can't get in my car and try to do in my car what she does in the Camry.
because they were made differently. Y'all gonna catch me in a minute. The manual that came with her car is different than the manual that came with my car. There are buttons that can be pressed in her car, but if you press them in mine, it'll erase some stuff. Feel like preaching in here. You've been trained to say certain stuff to folk and tell them they're on their way to hell and all this, that, and the other. I understand sometimes we do have to tell them that, but not all the time should that be our approach.
That's right.
You need to consult the manual. You need to consult God. How do I say what I need to say? Matter of fact, God, is it even for me to say anything right now in the first place? Sometimes the stuff that you're saying can be hurting folks more than it's helping them.
Yes.
Then there's other times that you need to give them tough love.
Yes.
But you gotta be sensitive to the Holy Ghost to know which one is which.
Watch this. The whole point of my message, again, I'll give the other part next week because that's the most important part. But my title was No More Stones.
No more stones.
No more stones.
I remember a woman who was caught in the act of adultery.
Yes.
And the very first thing they did was brought her to Jesus. And they said, Master, the law requires that she be stoned. To death.
Yes.
Yeah.
Now these are the religious folk talking.
Uh-huh.
Not the world.
Right. That's it. Right.
Religious folk.
Yes.
Church people are telling.
Church folk.
Kill
her. Kill her.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
I am so over.
Yes.
Church folk.
Uh-huh.
Who want to stone somebody.
Yes.
Cause they get caught.
That's right.
Church folk who want to stone folk.
Yes.
Because they don't do it like you think they ought to do it.
That's right.
You wonder why they don't want to come to your
church.
Come on.
Church.
Come
on.
Yes.
Right.
Jesus.
They see too much in you.
Yes.
It doesn't look like God.
That's right.
Lord,
have mercy.
Let me close this.
Help us.
No more
help us,
stones.
No more stones.
Jesus says, show me where you laid him.
Yes.
But he stinks. Show me.
Show me.
What's going on in my life is decaying. Show me. What you can reveal, he can resurrect.
Yes, Lord. Amen.
So he gives one more command, which is where I'll stop today. He tells them, roll away the stone. Roll away the stone. Saints, somebody sitting next to you needs you. Just because they came to church looking good doesn't mean they don't need a stone.
Yes.
Just because they came to church today and it looks like their family is okay doesn't mean they don't need a stone rolled away. The question is, who's going to be the person? Wait. The persons. The persons who will roll the stone away.
Yes.
If we're going to get miracles, if we're going to see breakthrough,
no
more stones.
No.
Today, God spoke to two groups of people primarily.
Yeah.
Those with some stuff that's paralyzed.
Yes.
Or in a dying condition.
Yeah.
And then he spoke to those who are waiting on some things.
Yeah.
And they may not even necessarily be for you. They could be for other people.
Jesus.
And God, for some of us, He showed up early. For others, He showed up what we would describe as late. But He's going to get some glory.
Yes.
He's going to get some glory.
Yes.
He's going to get some glory.
Yes. Yes.
Am I talking to somebody?
Yes.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, if you're in either one of those first two groups, I need you to jump up on your feet right now. If you were in either one of those first two groups that I've talked about today, jump up on your feet right now. If you're that Lazarus that has some paralyzed places, jump up on you. I don't care if it's physical. I don't care if it's emotional. See,